Five, four, three, two.
Greetings once more. It's nice to see that you came back. We are going to continue our presentation on apostasy, theological analysis of the Davidian movement. We're going to enter into the fourth presentation. Haraf Hutef promotes a kingdom of glory before the return of Jesus. I would like to mention real quick. I'm not going to enter into all the intricacies of the development of the kingdom. But the kingdom develops in two stages, two instances. First, the kingdom of grace, and then the kingdom of glory. The kingdom of grace, I can tell you that, began from the very Garden of Eden. As soon as Adam and Eve sinned, they needed somebody to rescue them. And there was Jesus, willing to do the sacrifice. And he also did the promise so that they would understand that someone was willing to sacrifice on their behalf. I would like for us to pray at this time so that we can enter into today's presentation. Blessed and lovely Father in heaven, again, we thank you for your kindness, for your love, for being so good to us, for allowing us once more to open thy word and to be filled by it. In Jesus' name, amen. So how long is the kingdom of grace going to begin? Jesus, if you remember when he was on this earth, he said that the kingdom of grace begins where? Begins in your heart. And it will not end. It started, began in the Garden of Eden, and is going to end at the close of probation. The reason why I mention this is because Haraf promoted a kingdom of glory, but very little he said about the kingdom of grace. And the fact is that if you do not enter into the kingdom of grace, you will never make it to the kingdom of glory. So we're going to talk a little about this kingdom of glory before the close of probation. This is what he was presenting in his literature and in his talks whenever he had the opportunity, either in church or in whatever meetings he had with his groups. A literal kingdom of glory beginning in Palestine to protect God's children from the plagues and persecution during a time of trouble. Sounds good? Of course sounds good. We're going to be protected from the plagues. We're going to be protected from persecution. I want to be in that kingdom. We're not going to suffer any of the consequences of government trying to eliminate us if we don't comply with their laws. It will extend to the whole earth before the close of probation. It'll preserve the animals which will populate the new earth so that God will not have to recreate them. It'll be the chosen site for the throne of God and all the heavenly angels while Jesus conducts the judgment of the living right here on planet earth before the close of probation, before the second coming of Christ, this side of the millennium. So what is the nature of this kingdom of glory that Haraf was projecting, promoting? Well, he said that initially it was going to be 144,000. That's in Shepherd's Rod series, page 488. Then he said that there was going to be 200 million individuals that were going to come after the 144,000. And he got that number from Revelation 9, verse 16. He misapplied one of the prophecies that appear in the scriptures there. And he said that there's going to be 200 million that is going to join the 144,000 in the kingdom. And after that, then follows the great multitude of Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. And of course, he says that after that, it's going to extend to the whole earth. The important thing that we have to remember is that he said that this was going to take place before the close of probation. In other words, just picture it in your mind. There's going to be this kingdom of glory, this glorious place in Palestine, where whole planet Earth, all the governments of this world will be able to witness that a kingdom is being established in there, that there's animals that are going in there, and these animals are going to be tamed. These animals are not going to behave like animals usually do. The lion is not going to eat the lamb, and so forth. And this is the kind of kingdom that he is projecting before the close of probation. He said, the Lord reigns first over Jerusalem, and finally after the saints are gathered in from the four winds of the earth, parts of the earth, then it'll extend completely to planet Earth. Jerusalem, particularly the Mount of Olives, he says that is going to be flattened completely before the close of probation. And I continue to stress the fact that he continued to say before the close of probation, because I continue to think, you know, are people going to be able to witness that? I mean, are they going to see the Mount of Olives flattened? I mean, I remember being there, and this is not a little hill. I mean, it's not a tall mountain, but it's not a little hill that you flatten it and no one is going to notice. But he says that this Mount of Olives is going to be flattened before the close of probation. Jesus reigns invisible, and Harof is going to be the visible king of God's kingdom. He will own all the riches of the Gentiles. He's going to have control of all the finances. And you're going to see later on, I'm going to show you what else he says, how he is planning to do it. You see, while he was in Waco, Texas, in his compound, he built his own bank. He had his own money. He had made out of cardboard carton. He made his own money, yeah. And he had green coins and blue coins. And the people that were inside the compound, they had to deal whatever business they had to do it with Harof's money. So guess who had the real American dollars to deal outside of the compound? You guessed correctly. Harof was the only one that was managing the money. It's interesting that one of the things that he did in this compound in order to keep complete control of the individuals that went into that place, he isolated the children from the parents, and they had the first story and the second story, and on the bottom, you know, the first story, you know, where the parents and all the children were placed in the second story. It had a reason for that, but I'll probably tell you later on what was the reason, why the isolation and why this type of control over the people that were there. All the assets of the Seventh-day Adventist Church will go to the Davidians once the kingdom is established. Now, just think, it's not going to be just 144,000. It's going to be 200 million. So can you imagine how much housing he would have to build in there in order to have welcome all those people in there? And can you just think in your mind how long it would take to build the place that is going to sustain all those people that are coming into the kingdom, particularly after you hear what were his plans in that place? And I'll tell you in a minute. The church, that is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, is going to be stripped of all their money, assets, their buildings, and all is going to go to the Davidians. That's exactly why Haddof counseled all the members of the Davidian movement. He said, do not leave the church. Do not build any churches. Remain in the church, because as soon as Ezekiel 9 takes place and all the Seventh-day Adventists are eliminated, then we're going to keep everything that they own. Well, it ain't going to be that much, because the Adventist church is not one of those multi-million, multi-billion. I mean, we're all the time asking the brothers and sisters, you know, to sacrifice and to contribute so that we can extend the gospel to those in need in the world. But still, he thought that there was a lot of money out there, and he thought that he was going to take control of all of it. Planet Earth will be once again paradise. That's what he had in mind. He is the promised Elijah, and he is going to restore all things. God's kingdom, according to V.T. Haddof, all animals will be tamed, docile, as in the Garden of Eden. Then Sister White is going to be resurrected. I don't know if he was planning to resurrect her, because he said that he was going to restore everything. But according to what he said, Sister White is going to be resurrected, and she'll be in the kingdom. She'll be resurrected before the close of probation to take her work once again. There will be marriages, children, and all kind of business taking place in this kingdom. Now, you remember what Jesus said, that in his kingdom, after the resurrection, when the kingdom, the real kingdom is established, are there going to be any marriages then? Are there going to be any more children? That's what the Lord said. The heavenly sanctuary will be located in Palestine, where the Mount of Olives stands today. Adventists who do not embrace the rod message will not be allowed in Haddof's kingdom. They all will be killed. Therefore, he says, Shepherd's Rod Series, page 216, therefore Jerusalem, the place where the feet of the Lord shall stand, will become the great international and spiritual divide for the everlasting gospel. So from Palestine, he is going to evangelize the whole world. Moreover, in that day, the Lord's feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, and the mountain cleaves toward the east and toward the west, making a great valley. Then to this valley of the mountains, to the place where the Lord's feet stand, the people of God flee as hastily as from an earthquake. Thus is Jerusalem to be re-inhabited by God's own people. Plainly, Jerusalem is to become the great gathering place for God's people. In a minute, we're going to see if that is in agreement, in harmony with the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. In page 216 of the Shepherd's Rod series, he says, "The Lord reigns first over Jerusalem, and finally, after the saints are gathering from the four corners of the earth, he reigns over the whole earth." This is Jesus reigning on planet earth before the close of probation. But remember what he said. Jesus is going to be invisible, and Victor Haddof is going to sit on his throne, and he will allow Victor Haddof to rule over the people. Now we see that this event, the Lord standing on the mount and the saints fleeing to the valley, is not only premillennial, but even pre-probationary. You see what I'm telling you? Before probation closed. That it commences the reestablishment of the house of Judah, that it prepares the way for lightening the earth with the glory of the angel in Revelation 18:1, that it is eventually to bring the end of sinners. I thought that was Jesus, the one that was going to end sin on this earth. Page 366, as Noah's Ark preserved every living thing that was to inhabit the earth after the flood, in like manner the restored kingdom of Judah and Israel is to gather and preserve from the plagues every living thing that is to inhabit the new earth. The kingdom restored is to be the ark in our day, and her people shall live and reign 1,000 years with Christ, and finally return when the earth is made new. So like I told you the last time that we were here, even the animals of planet earth, according to Haddof, they have a promise of redemption, salvation, so to speak. So they're going to be rescued from planet earth, taken to heaven, and then brought back 1,000 years after. Pre-Advent earthly kingdom. He quoted Isaiah 11, verses 11 to 14, and he states, "Here we see that there's to be peace in the valley of the mountains, peace between beast and beast, and also between man and man, for the lion shall not hurt the lamb, and Judah shall not vex Ephraim, and Ephraim shall not envy Judah." Remember, he thought that the 144,000 were not Gentiles. They were Jews, Jewish descendants. "Judah and Ephraim are nevertheless to be in conflict with the countries surrounding the land." I'm puzzled every time that I read this statement. I mean, here is a kingdom of glory. Here's the redeemed people inside the kingdom of God already. And if they're already inside, that means that these individuals have the seal of the living God. They are already in. These individuals have acquired a perfect character. But nonetheless, he says that they're going to be in conflict with the countries surrounding the land, for they shall fly upon the shoulders of the Palestinians and lay hand upon Edom and Moab. The Ammonites, though, shall obey them. And of course, he's going to say, but that's what the Bible says. Yeah, but that doesn't mean that you have to apply it according to your will. You're not to do any personal interpretation of what the Bible says. God's people in these last days shall be gathered from every land, not from the land of Egypt. Thus shall the kingdom of Judah and Israel be restored and be given peace and plenty. You know, that was a fatal precedent. If you remember, one of the reasons why the Jewish church, the Jewish nation, the Jewish people did not receive Jesus as their Messiah is because they were hoping for what kind of kingdom? A kingdom of peace and safety. Here's going to come this Messiah, and he is powerful, and he is glorious, and he's going to overthrow the Roman Empire. And then we, the Jews, are going to control the whole world. And that's exactly what Viktor Harov is having in mind. A Messiah that was going to free them from the Roman yoke. He was to bring a kingdom of peace and safety to the nation. He would restore David's kingdom. Remember, Harav said that he was modern David. Okay? Therefore, they rejected the true Messiah. The kingdom promoted by Viti Harav is illusory. It deters the people from the need of preparation. It is a satanic deception. And I don't have any problems stating that, because there's no other way to define what he was presenting to the people. So what is the problem with this kingdom? The Lord himself warned us of those that were to bring a message of peace and safety. People would be so confident that they would neglect their preparation for Jesus' second coming in the clouds. He is coming for a church without spot or wrinkle. All the washing and ironing is to be done before the close of probation. No mediator after the close of probation. You remember what Revelation 22:11 says. Those that are righteous continue to be righteous. But those that are unrighteous, they will continue to be unrighteous. There is no second probation after that. Of course, Harav says that there is, but the Bible and the spirit of prophecy are clear, saying that there is no second probation. At the close of probation, all have been declared either righteous or lost. The Holy Spirit will withdraw from planet Earth, and there will be no middle point. Is there harmony between Harav and the spirit of prophecy? No, there's not. Although he said that his writings were in perfect harmony with the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, that all his ideas were irrefutable, that everything that he published was truth. The kingdom of God's grace is now being established as day by day hearts that have been full of sin and rebellion yield to the sovereignty of his love. But the full establishment of the kingdom, this is Sister White speaking. This is in the book Amazing Grace, page 347. The kingdom of God's grace is now being established as day by day hearts that have been full of sin and rebellion yield to the sovereignty of his love. This section of God's kingdom, the kingdom of grace, is precisely to prepare people for the kingdom of glory. No one that is going to be unhappy in the kingdom of glory is going to be allowed there. So what is this period of time known as the kingdom of grace or the time for grace? What is this time for? It's to train God's people how to be happy, how to live in heaven and enjoy themselves. I mean, come on. People that are accustomed to sin in planet Earth, that enjoy sinning, that have cherished sins, that they don't want to abandon them. Do you think that the Lord is going to allow them in his kingdom? No, that's precisely. I mean, we're all in training. Whether you can see that or not, we are all in training now so that we learn here on planet Earth how to live in heaven. I think that that makes sense. Does it? I think so. But the full establishment of the kingdom of his glory will not take place until the second coming of Christ to this world. Is Sister White clear in that? And it's exactly what it says in the scriptures. I mean, all you have to do is read Matthew 25:31. Not until the personal advent of Christ can his people receive the kingdom. It's not until Christ appears for the second time. The Lord is emphatic when he states that the kingdom will not be established until the second kingdom. Matthew 25:31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he sit upon the throne of his glory. I mean, if Jesus do not sit on the throne of his glory until the second coming, why would somebody have the idea that they can establish a kingdom of glory before the close of probation? The Bible clearly states that not until the second coming of Christ will the kingdom be established. Daniel chapter 7, verse 27 says, and the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. So is God's kingdom of glory going to be everlasting, eternal? That means that once established is not going to be destroyed again? That's what it means. Once God's kingdom of glory is established, is going to be everlasting, is forever. So just think about it. If Haddof would be right and there's a kingdom of glory, as he suggests, built or established before the close of probation, and at Jesus' second coming, fire is going to descend from heaven and is going to burn everything on planet Earth. And there's going to be a great earthquake that is going to destroy everything that is on this planet. So what do you think is going to happen to that kingdom of glory established in Palestine? It would have to be destroyed. So is Haddof in harmony with what the Bible says? Of course not. The Bible clearly states that not until the second coming of Christ will the kingdom be established. Christ is going to be the one to establish the kingdom. Amazing Grace, page 347. Man in his present state is mortal, corruptible, but the kingdom of God will be incorruptible, enduring forever. Therefore, man in his present state cannot enter the kingdom of God. Once again, is Haddof, what did he think that he was going to be able to transform the individuals that were going to join him in the kingdom? Do you see that subtly he was taking rights and taking a position that was only given to Jesus? So although he never said, I am the resurrected Jesus, but nonetheless, he was ascribing to himself characteristics that only belong to Jesus. And that's why after him, Rodin, he thought that he would be the branch, Jesus. Then David Koresh, he claimed that he was the Christ. Why? If Haddof can do it, why can't I? And Jesus prophesied that from the very beginning. Matthew 24 said that there's going to be many that are going to come before second coming. Many are going to come in my name, saying that I am the Christ. And we have seen that over and over and over. And every one of them, where are they? They're gone. But when Jesus comes, he confers immortality upon his people. And then he calls them to inherit the kingdom of which they have hitherto been only heirs. That's what we are. We are heirs of the kingdom. The spirit of prophecy and Ellen White was in perfect harmony with the Bible. We don't have any questions about Sister White's inspiration. When I first began to study the Adventist message, one of the things that caused me a little trouble was precisely that. I mean, there's a prophetess in this church. I got to take this, you know, with silky hands. You know, I gotta really check these out. So I gave myself to the task of reading The Great Controversy. And in 4 months, I had never read the Bible or anything because I grew up, you know, between the Catholic Church and the Pentecostal Church and the Presbyterian Church and the Jehovah's Witnesses. I attended all those different denominations seeking. I was seeking for the truth. So now when I come to this Adventist church and they're claiming that they're living according to what the Bible says, that what they teach is in harmony with the Bible, and now they tell me that there is a prophetess in their midst, I want to see what this lady says. And if I have an opportunity and if I see something, I'm going to prove her wrong. I had never read the Bible before, but in 4 months, I read the Bible from cover to cover. In 4 months, I read Steps to Christ. In 4 months, I read The Great Controversy and most of The Desire of Ages. And after I read those writings, I had to surrender myself to God's grace and say, there's no question about it. I can find no fault in the writings of this lady. And then I had the scriptures, Revelation 12, 17, 19, 10, the spirit of prophecy in the midst of the remnant people. And I said, I have to give in. I have to join this church. I can do no other. And since then, almost 50 years ago, by God's grace, I have been attending the Adventist church. Even those 4 years, remember I told you that I spent 4 years within this organization, the Davidian organization. Even those 4 years, I had so many problems and troubles with the shepherd's rod. Why? Because I continued to faithfully attend the church. This is my church. This is the church that I love. I mean, if you guys are going to tell me that I can't attend this church, then don't tell me that this is a ministry to help the church carry on with the gospel unto all the world, which is what they, you know, said at all times. Since at the beginning I did not have all the literature, all the published literature of Victor Hadov, I didn't have any means to check, you know, what they were saying and what this gentleman was saying. And of course, they use these illustrations. They have these charts. And in this illustration, the first one that they'll present you is an image of the dream of Nebuchadnezzar. Remember the statue of Nebuchadnezzar? And you see that statue in there, and you can't help it but say, they got to be Adventists. And so I stayed in there for those 4 years, but continuous fighting because I attended church. Every meeting, whatever it was on Wednesday, Friday night, Saturday, during the day, I'd be there. in the Adventist church, thinking in spite of the fact that I was with this group, I still was thinking of myself as a real Seventh-day Adventist, unlike them who did not attend the meetings only on Sabbath, and as soon as the Sabbath school class finished, that was it. They would not stay. They would go away. They would not contribute financially with the church. And so I am so glad, you know, that I was able to get this information. And I am an avid reader. I love to read. So as soon as I had that information in my hand, that was it. Now the Holy Spirit can open up my eyes and allow me to see that I was part of a heresy. Although personally I was not, but I was running along with heretical individuals. The spirit of prophecy says the full establishment of the kingdom of his glory will not take place till the second coming of Christ. Review and Herald, November 14, 1912. His kingdom will not come until the good tidings of his grace shall have been carried to all the earth. Matthew 24:14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Now, Haddock said that the kingdom of glory that he was promoting, projecting, was to protect the members of God's people, the church, God's church, to protect them from the plagues. He declared the kingdom to be one of protection during the seven last plagues. According to Haddock, all the members of the kingdom would be gathered in Palestine where the plagues would not fall. Have you seen that anywhere in the Bible? I haven't. Somebody help me out. I mean, I have read the Bible so many times from one cover to the other, and I never came across something like that. The Bible, not the spirit of prophecy, neither one of them partake of such idea. Great controversy. 626. Davidians don't like this statement from Sister White. If they can avoid having to answer any concerned Seventh-day Adventist that would quote it to them, he would. As the decree issued by the various rulers of Christendom against commandment keepers shall withdraw the protection of government and abandon them to those who desire their destruction, the people of God will flee from the cities and villages and associate together in companies, dwelling in the kingdom that Haddock is going to build in Palestine. That's not what it says in there. Dwelling in the most desolate and solitary places, many will find refuge in the strongholds of the mountains. Like the Christians of the Pitman Valleys, they will make the high places of the earth their sanctuaries and will thank God for the munitions of rocks. I had the opportunity to go to the Sequoia Park, and some of those mountains have these enormous, but yet round, completely smooth, beautiful stones in there. And it made me think, you know, of some of these statements from Sister White. But many of all nations, continues Great Controversy 626, many of all nations and of all classes, high and low, rich and poor, black and white, will be cast into the most unjust and cruel bondage. The beloved of God pass weary days, bound in chains, shut in by prison bars, sentenced to be slain, some apparently left to die of starvation in dark and loathsome dungeons. No human ear is open to hear their moans. No human hand is ready to lend them help. Are they in agreement, Victor Hadov and Ellen G. White? No, they're not. Completely different set of statements. Protected from the seven last plagues, not according to Sister White. The people of God, quoting Great Controversy, now page 635. Some in prison cells, some hidden in solitary retreats in the forest and the mountains, still plead for divine protection, while in every quarter companies of armed men, urged on by hosts of evil angels, are preparing for the work of death. The death decree has been already signed. It is now in the hour of utmost extremity that the God of Israel will interpose for the deliverance of his children. Not by building a kingdom in Palestine. The Lord do not need to do that in order to protect his children. Now, in regard to the coming of the Son of Man, this will not take place until after the mighty earthquake shakes the earth, after the people have heard the voice of God. They are in despair and trouble such as never was since there was a nation, and in this the people of God will suffer affliction. So are they going to be protected from the plagues? They're going to be protected from the direct effect of the plagues, but they will still suffer the consequences, okay? When the voice of God turns the captivity of his people, there is a terrible awakening of those who have lost all in the great conflict of life. Let's see if I can clarify this. As soon as the plagues begin to fall, all the children of God have received the seal of the living God. You remember Revelation 7. Hold the winds until when? Until the sealing is completed. After the sealing is completed, now there can be all kind of disasters upon planet Earth. It doesn't make any difference. None of those that have the seal of the living God will be moved from the truth or will perish. Their protection is assured. There will be no dying after the close of probation. We will be sustained by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is going to withdraw from planet Earth, from the sinners, but not from the children of God. The 144,000. Sister White says that they themselves have endured suffering, hunger, and thirst, but not death. They won't die. See, Sister White on the Bible is clear. It says their bread and water is assured. You know, they're not going to have, up in the mountains, they're not going to have a microwave, you know, or they're not going to have a, you know, refrigerator and whatever. But the Lord is going to protect them and provide for their need that short time, okay? Hadov said, when the gospel work has replenished the earth with born-again people, then probation will cease and our work will be ended. In other words, according to Hadov, who is going to convert, who is going to turn the whole planet into born-again people? Victor Hadov and the Davidians. And that is completely contrary to the truth. He left no room for misinterpretations of his ideas. Though there will be only 144,000, that's what Hadov said, cut by God's own might and taken to Mount Zion, yet they as servants and as the first fruits are to gather in the great multitude which no man could number of Revelation 7:9. Thus will they enlarge the kingdom that is finally to fill the earth. Now, what kind of activities are going to take place in this kingdom that Hadov had in mind? the members of the kingdom church had of said are according to Isaiah. You can read Isaiah, I mean, as much as you want. And there are things that he added them. They're not in the scriptures. I checked it out. According to Isaiah, to be skilled in their respective trades and professions as builders, engineers, carpenters, masons, mechanics in God's kingdom. I mean, what's going to be broken in there? Or whatever. They are to build the old ways, raise up the former desolations, and repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. But he said some of the things. They're also to be animal husbandmen, vine growers, expert agriculturists. And as such, they are to be skilled in the science of management. So what are they going to manage in there? Employing thousands of aliens? Uh-huh. What kind of aliens? And where do the aliens come from? And if he was referring just to foreigners, you know, people outside of the kingdom, other nations, unconverted nations, so they're going to employ unconverted individuals into God's kingdom of glory? Management employing thousands of aliens, not only to minister to their needs and to build, but also to stand and feed their flocks and to be their plowmen and vine dressers. And he quotes Isaiah, but when you read Isaiah, read it carefully, because he interjects words that were not in Isaiah's mind or the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So that's why when you read strange things, you know, these flyers that they bring to church and little books that they share with you and whatever, check them out. Check them out. What kind of aliens? There's going to be also banks in the kingdom. You see, he had a bank in Waco, Texas, and he was benefiting from it. So he thought, you know, I can, you know, with God's help, you know, if God is going to help me, you know, I can have a bank in there that I'm going to be loaded with money. Besides being skilled agronomists, this is him writing, artisans, tradesmen. What are tradesmen? These are the people, you know, in other nations that when you go in there, you know, you exchange your money for their kind of money. That's what tradesmen are. These governors of the kingdom, as living embodiments of genuine Christianity, are to be expert international. Have any one of you worked in a bank? I had the opportunity, the privilege to work when I was a young man. I worked for Chase Manhattan Bank in New York. I had the opportunity to go to the Federal Reserve. You know, it doesn't belong to the United States. It's not. I mean, they call it, you know, the Federal Reserve of the United States, but it's not. It doesn't belong to the United States. But I went all the way down to where they burn the money, you know, the money that is sent by the banks, you know, owe money. You know, they send it in there to reprint it, and then they burn it. And I saw when they were burning it. But I also saw gold. There was lots of gold. And I don't know if you know anything about Puerto Ricans, but Puerto Ricans are very, very, very curious individuals. So I couldn't wait until the lady that was doing the speech in there finished the speech. And I said, can I please touch one of those, you know, bricks of gold? And I thought, you know, and she did it on purpose, you know. I mean, I extended my hand and she just dropped it in there. I mean, that thing is heavy. I almost dropped it on the floor. So this gentleman is saying that there in Palestine, no, I didn't take any gold with me. Don't start thinking that. I did not take any gold, not any of the money. She was behind bars. She was protected. And, you know, it was something that some people that work in bank, you know, had the opportunity to do. And I had the chance, and I went for it. So I went to see what was there. International bankers. If they are international bankers, that means that in the kingdom of God, there's going to be money, trading, and business. Does it sound like the kingdom of God? Of course it doesn't. Economists, personnel, and traffic engineers. Traffic in the kingdom of God? I mean, I can't help but think about the flying saucers. You know, I imagine that they got to have a place to land. And, of course, they're going to need mechanics in case that one of the flying saucers, you know, since they are, you know, heavenly mechanism, who knows? You know, maybe one of them failed and they got to have somebody that knows how to fix flying saucers. And provisioners together handling the forces and the riches, the money of the Gentiles. Mundane activities in God's kingdom. Why would they need traffic engineers? What kind of transportation? Why international bankers? Whose money are they going to deal with? Mechanics to fix what? What kind of vehicles? Are there going to be broken machines in God's kingdom? Trading? Who's foreign money? Employing aliens? From where? What kind? Are these not legitimate questions? Of course they are. And once I read that from Haddock's writings, and I went to the administration building in Mountaindale, New York, where the headquarters of the Davidians are, and I went there with a 66-page presentation, and I said, look, brothers, this is nothing but heresy. And I got the proof in here. I got the evidence in my hands to prove it. As soon as they look at it, you know what their response was? You have to leave the organization, and that is now. Guess what I did? I went to the office, packed up my things, put them in my car, went back home. Didn't question anybody, because if they're willing to believe these heretical ideas, you never know what they'll be willing to do in order to defend those beliefs. Since the Sunday law comes before the plagues, then if everybody would be gathered in a kingdom before close to probation, okay, they're all gathered in the kingdom. All of a sudden, the Sunday law is signed and enforced. Does the government have to go looking for that, Venice? All they got to do is drop a bomb in there, and that was it. Kill them all. That's it. They're all gathered in the kingdom, and they want to get rid of all the Sabbath keepers. So if they are together in one place, easy to get rid of them. So that's very easy to see. The death decree will come into effect after probation close. If all the saved ones are already gathered in Palestine, nations of the world will have no problem to find them. Since Sister White, a proven true prophet of God, says that after the close of probation and the issuance of the death decree, the saints will be found in small companies, hiding in caves, mountains, and forests throughout the planet, it casts legitimate doubts regarding Haddock's claims. But some people, many Adventists, they want to believe that idea that they're going to be protected in this place. And the fact is that Davidians have plenty of ammunition. I mean, they take small statements from Sister White, one verse and another from different places in the Bible, in order to sustain some of their ideas. And you know, it's easy to do that. There's people that will grab one statement in the scriptures and will make a doctrine out of it. Of course, Sister White said that we have to use the way of evidence. I mean, isn't that what the Bereans did? What did they do? They went and they checked out. I mean, not even Paul got away, you know, without being checked by the Bereans, you know. They checked them all out. But it's a sad thing to see that Seventh-day Adventists are willing to believe these individuals that come without enough evidence from the scriptures, and they're willing to follow them, and they're willing to send their tithe. And I asked one of those individuals that was sending their tithe to Davidians and other independent ministries separated from the church. And I asked these individuals, do you ever check what they do with that money? And why did you start sending your money to these independent ministries in the first place? Oh, I started sending it in there because I heard that there was misadministration with the money that goes to the conference, that they're not administering the money correctly. And I said to this person, you know, I used to belong to the conference board. And you know what? Every meeting that we had, the treasurer informs how are the finances. In church, every year we have a business meeting and we know how the finances are. And the conference is always open for whatever you want to ask about it. What a difference. May we all remain loyal, faithful to the Lord, and if faithful to the Lord, faithful to His church. Can we pray? Blessed and lovely Father in heaven, again we thank you for your kindness, for being so good to us. Help us, Lord, that we continue to remain faithful to you until that day when you come in the clouds to take us home. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. May God bless you.